All set, Lily?
Yes.
Okay, Ted. Camera right, please, and down, and mark it.
All right, Mr. Frankfurt.
It's been said that you brought Madison Avenue to Sunset Boulevard. How did you get involved with Hollywood from New York?
Well, I've been told for many years that from the time I was fairly young, I was starstruck. I was always fascinated with the movies. I think someone told me, it went really back to my mom. She was an assistant and a secretary to the head of Columbia Pictures here in New York. And then she went off to work for Republic Pictures, which was the home place of all of the serials, which kids grew up on, serials being movies, et cetera. So it's always been a piece of me that's been really stuck in Hollywood. I went to California, I was still in school, to look for a job. And lo and behold, I couldn't find one. And I was walking the streets of Los Angeles, which is, you know, comparable to walking in the Grand Canyon, looking for interviews and for possibilities of leaving my resume. Nothing happened, and this went on for a number of weeks. I got very disappointed. I was down, I just felt terrible about it. Why weren't they hiring me? I knew I had some talent, I thought at least. And one day I showed up at the office of a man named Jim Cantwell, who was KNX, which is a CBS affiliate out there. And it was on my list of people that I'm supposed to talk to, maybe he could show the portfolio. I showed him my work. To my utter amazement, he loved it. And I mean, all of a sudden I just felt, oh my God, maybe there'll be a job.
Hi, I'm Robert Osborne. Thanks so much for joining us. We're about to salute a man who made a very distinct mark on film history. His name is Steven Frankfurt. Name you may not recognize, but you've definitely seen his work. Frankfurt is a pioneer in the advertising arm of show business, and over the years he created ad campaigns for films such as Rosemary's Baby, Alien.
I got involved with Kramer versus Kramer. Alien was one of my more unusual assignments. That line, "Pray for Rosemary's Baby," began to grow. I thought that the front was a very, very important.
My involvement with Superman was everything.
I was at Young and Rubicam. I was their creative head in the art department.
Well, our next film with a Frankfurt connection is a little different than the others because this time he wasn't asked to create the movie's poster or their trailer. Instead, he was asked to create the film's opening credits.
This is Bob Mulligan, and my memory of first seeing these images that Steve Frankfurt came up with was astonishing, in that he put us directly into the movie, right from the very first frame, and using the whole visual theme of the cigar box, which is also a part of the movie, and a part of the interior world of those children, sharing mysteries, and some of it so directly connected to Boo, he just did a wonderful job.
Now, this marked Steven Frankfurt's first foray into the actual movie-making process. Before this, he was strictly an ad man, creating campaigns for everything from Jell-O gelatin to Frito-Lay potato chips. He was particularly known, though, for doing campaigns which appealed to children. And because of that, producer Alan Pakula thought Frankfurt would be an ideal guy to create the credits for our next movie, which has so much to do with children.
I got a call one day from Alan Pakula, and Alan was going to produce a film called To Kill a Mockingbird that Bob Mulligan, his partner, was going to direct. Alan knew about me because he had seen the work I'd done with children, particularly with young children, through the baby products and the like, and asked me if I'd like to do a movie title. And I said, I would love to do a movie title. What's that? And how do you do it?
Frankfurt took the job and decided what would be most effective would be to do the opening credits as if they were coming from the mind of the young girl who's at the center of this story, a girl named Scout.
So I was looking for a way to get into her head in terms of what she was thinking, what she was really all about, and to learn about her because if this was going to be a title section, it would be a way to set up the premise of the film in a very succinct way, and yet a way that would be very touching. I remembered that Scout and her other buddy used to carry keep all the little treasures in a cigar box that they had in the in her dad's his own room. And I decided I would try to find a way to find a cigar box, and that becomes the treasures, really became the treasures of a little girl's life. I went and found a little girl here in the city. I took her over to Tony Schwartz's studio, who was the best sound documentarian around, and I sat on the floor with her in the basement for 2.5 hours talking to ourselves. And we took that track and we used it against my cigar box. And I decided to use a marble in the box and let it roll through the box and touch another marble as a downbeat to bring in this music. The funny part of the story, though, is that nobody knew how I did it. The only person that knew how we made that happen was a man who I was thought was a bloody genius in this business. His name was Lou Wasserman. He literally was the most powerful man in all of the history of the movie business. And he came in when we were shooting this thing, and he said, "You put a magnet in the marble, right?" I said, "Did someone tell you?" He said, "Of course no one told me. That's the only way you could have done it." I said, "I'm very impressed," and he walked out. The sketch was really done to create stationery for Mr. Pakula. We sent a gal by the name of Bodie Boatwright, who was working for Allen at the time, and she was the assistant producer, all over the South. We set up contests in about 12 schools in the South for kids to draw mockingbirds. That's where the mockingbird drawing came from. That I used it in the way I used it, but it came from, there was a kid in Georgia who did the piece. Now, we used it as the end of the main title because my feeling was the tear, and if you listen to the little girl, she said, and we used that cut to segue to the trees and the branches of the town, and it has a way of just touching you in a very, very powerful way, whether to the heart, to the head, but you get it. The line that we came up with for the campaign was simply, "Pray for Rosemary's Baby." And I was looking for a way to take a line like that in the campaign and to use it in a way in media that would be unexpected. Again, resist the usual. We found a black baby stroller. We put it on a rock in Central Park, right across the street from the Dakota Apartments, which is where the movie takes place. And we shot it from a lower angle. George Eliot was the photographer. He was wonderful. Phil Gibbs was the designer. And we did it in a way that simply gave it a kind of an austere quality. And we superimposed Mia Farrow's head behind it as the background to the whole thing. And the only visual beyond that was simply the words, "Pray for Rosemary's Baby." I had the good fortune of not knowing what you couldn't do, so I wasn't breaking any rules. There were no rules, basically. And I took a shot at what I thought could be done, and that could be done well. Took it over to Paramount, showed it to the marketing department, and I would say to a man, they hated it. It was it wasn't movie advertising, as someone said to me, and for which I said thank you. I was trying to do something that wasn't movie advertising, but would have an impact on its own. Great scene, because I'm leaving their office and the elevator door is open on the floor where Paramount was, and four guys get out: Peter Bart, Robert Evans, Charles Bludorn, Marty Davis, and they're all coming up to the office. And they said, "Where are you going? We're coming here to see the work." I said, "I showed it to your people. They think it's wrong. They're probably right. I've got to go back to work." So Bludorn said, "Frankfurt, I want to see the work, please. We asked you, please show it to us." And so we recommended to them, this happened that very afternoon, to take the line, "Pray for Rosemary's Baby," and instead of doing great big posters and ads and so forth, simply run it in the birth announcement columns of every newspaper we could get into. It would cost nothing. But that line, "Pray for Rosemary's Baby," began to grow. But we also took the line and we stenciled it on every street corner in Manhattan. We didn't know what you couldn't do. They told me it was the beginning of guerrilla marketing. Who knew, you know? But it was on every street corner. It was on the steps of St. Patrick's Cathedral. Got trouble for that. However, that line became extremely memorable. Johnny Carson picked it up and was ending the show at night and saying, and remember, pray for Rosemary's Baby. Suddenly, it took on an advertising impact all of its own, and we had the picture pre-sold almost before the picture opened. I was just reaching into what we normally would do in an advertising campaign for Jell-O or Fritos potato chips or you name it, but it just seemed to be the right thing and it fit. And we were lucky in one sense. The boss was there, he loved it, they got behind it, and they let me do it in, quote, the way I wanted to do it.
I'm not a writer.
That's a very bizarre statement.
I thought that The Front was a very, very important film. It told a story that was, to me, was a very important part of the history of our country.
A powerful drama about the efforts of some blacklisted television writers in the 1950s, trying to get around their bleak situation in the wake of the House Un-American Activities Committee investigations. And how do they do it? Well, by hiring another man to accept credit for their work. And Woody Allen plays that front man.
Other guys wrote those scripts, not me. I put my name on them. They were blacklisted. I was helping them out.
You're not a writer.
No, I couldn't write a grocery list.
You never wrote any of those scripts?
Nothing, not one. I'm practically illiterate.
Woody took this on as a story in a way that was, I thought, very, very, very powerful. The surprise here was this was not a comedy, this was a tragedy.
It's a fictional story, but very much based on fact, made by several people who had actually been blacklisted in the 1950s, such as the film's director Martin Ritt, writer Walter Bernstein, and actor Zero Mostel. Now, the challenge for Steven Frankfurt was twofold. His advertising art had to establish that this was not the typical Woody Allen comedy. And he also had to remind people of the history behind the story, because after all, it had been over 20 years since the House Un-American Activities investigations. So Frankfurt developed a movie poster that was merely Woody Allen's familiar face in silhouette, accompanied by the following text, quote, "What if there was a list, and that list said our finest actors were not allowed to act, our best writers were not allowed to write,
our funniest comedians were not allowed to make us laugh. What would it be like if there were such a list? Well, it would be like America in 1953. It was finding a way to see Woody in a different way. He was the front for these 10 tremendously talented people who were tragic.
And that now brings us to a terrific action film from Warner Brothers in 1978. It's Superman the Movie, starring Marlon Brando, Gene Hackman, and in his film debut as the Man of Steel, Christopher Reeve. Now, Steven Frankfurt's association with this film began a year before cameras even began to roll. Frankfurt was hired by director Richard Donner and Warner Brothers to create a teaser trailer for the film. Now, if you're not familiar with that term, teaser trailer, it's a trailer typically done without using any footage from the film itself, something to merely whet the appetites of an audience for an upcoming feature. Frankfurt had two basic elements to work with on the Superman tease: the legend of the popular comic book hero and the film's very impressive cast. Well, he decided to have the names of the major actors in the cast flying through the atmosphere, accompanied by the music of Beethoven, and finishing with the famous S for Superman's logo.
I had gotten a call from Dick Donner, who directed the film, who was an old friend, and we had worked on Sanka Coffee together when we were doing commercials, and asked if Superman was something that interested us. Well, it interested me tremendously, because I was a kid that grew up on Superman. My brother Mike and I used to collect comic books. We had the first action comics that introduced Superman in the first place. So we knew Superman inside out and backwards.
Well, that teaser was first screened before an audience in San Francisco.
Doing the teaser trailer, I worked with a young designer who we had brought here from Chicago, Richie Greenberg was his name, and he did the animation for the how we would deal with the typography, but that was done literally practically in a matter of a week or two.
And it was so effective, the audience let out a collective roar. Everybody seemed to think they were about to see a surprise screening of the whole film, until the words, "Coming soon to a theater near you," appeared on the screen. When the audience saw that, a huge uproar broke out in the theater because people were so disappointed that this was just a trailer. Well, that whole reaction thrilled the bosses at Warner Brothers, who immediately had Frankfurt going to work on the marketing campaign for the whole film.
After that, we had the opportunity for Richie really to take some real serious homework time and figure out a stronger way to do it. And it gave us an opportunity to have John Williams' music, which I think is fantastic. And Superman as a picture was one in which we were involved really in kind of total immersion in terms of all forms of media, print, teaser trailers, trailer itself. We did the opening ad for the picture. We did that about 3 months before the film opened, and we convinced Warner Brothers that we could get the center spread space in Life magazine, which is really where you want it to be if you could ever be there. And we did it. We did a picture basically of Superman's Clark Kent's jacket opening and revealing for the first time the S. We didn't show Chris Reeves because nobody knew who he was. The funny part of the story was that it ran in Life magazine, and Life magazine helped us, although unbeknownst to them, they forgot to put the word advertising on top of the spread, which meant that it was an editorial cubbins for the picture. It was saying Life magazine must think this is great. They're giving us the whole center spread in the magazine. Well, of course, everybody at Warner Brothers was thrilled. I was delighted. And I got a call from Andrew High School. I was their advertising agency for Time Life at the time. And Andrew called me and he said, "Did you do that ad for Superman?" I said, "Well, yes, we did. Why?" He said, "You've caused me a great deal of problem." I said, "What happened?" He said, "You left out the word advertising." I said, "Andrew, that's not our role. Our role is to give you the ad, and you put the word advertising." I said, "You guys forgot." He said, "I know, Steve." He said, "I'm very upset." He said, "But I'm thrilled. It's a great looking ad." P.S. That's the way the picture got launched, and it was a very successful launch, to say the least. Interestingly, in doing the main title, we started the main title on a very tiny screen. It opened at the Ziegfeld Theater. This started in a small screen, black and white. There was a little boy reading the comics out of Action Comics, explaining how Superman came from Krypton.
In the decade of the 1930s, even the great city of Metropolis was not spared the ravages of the worldwide depression. In the times of fear and confusion, the job of informing the public was the responsibility of the Daily Planet, a great metropolitan newspaper whose reputation for clarity and truth had become a symbol of hope for the city of Metropolis.
On a cue word, and the music made this happen, the whole thing began to open up to a 40 or a 50 foot screen that absolutely sent chills through everybody in the audience. And by the time the main titles were over, we got a standing ovation. Alien was one of my more unusual assignments. What do you put into the advertising that would sell it, or pre-sell it, if you will? And my feeling was you put nothing into the advertising except find a way to talk about it, because you couldn't show what happens in the picture in an ad any more than Ridley Scott could have explained it to me over the telephone, because you had to experience it. However, we had to find a way to talk about Alien and make it more than, in quote, a hype sci-fi picture, because it certainly was a hell of a lot more than that. In space, no one can hear you scream. It's a line that anybody could accept, and it said a lot about the mystery or the unknown. You just got it. One of the things about a tagline that I believe is very important, and I feel this with everything I work on, or that I have worked on, is what I call involvement. Because to me, involvement, if the viewer's involvement is a part of this thing, involvement is the first step to persuasion. Find a way to communicate in some fashion that really stops the viewer. Well, the texture of the planet was rather amusing because the texture of the planet was created and baked by one of the gals in our place. And it's brownies. We couldn't figure out what the surface of that planet would have looked like. So someone said, I'll bake the planet for you. And she came in with a whole bunch of brownies. And lo and behold, you were in space. And then for the use of television and for the trailer and the teaser trailer, the word in this thing was alien. And what we did is we simply took apart the word alien and all of the ups and downs of creating the word, the A-L-I and so forth. And we use those words to build those forms, to build the word itself. And I think somebody who didn't like it said, it looks like a pharmaceutical ad. And my comment to that was, thank you. As long as you tell me it doesn't look like a movie ad. That's Entertainment was the most fun time I've ever had working on a movie, or ever will have, I'm sure. And when Danny Melnick, who produced it, and Jack Haley, who's his partner, called to ask if I'd like to work on it, I said, I will pay you if you will let me work on this picture.
When this film came out, it was preceded with a publicity line that read, boy, do we need it now. And boy, we still do, more than ever.
We decided the best visual that I thought we could have was to use the names of the stars. And if you look at the teaser trailer.
Elizabeth Taylor, Fred Astaire, Gene Kelly, James Stewart, Debbie Reynolds, Mickey Rooney, Bing Crosby.
One after another, coming at you, bang, 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 bang. It was gasping time. I mean, you had goosebumps all over you listening to this going on one after another after another.
I was a seasoned performer of 17 when I first worked with Judy Garland.
The trailer itself started with a small black and white screen in the midst of this huge screen. Again, it was a Ziegfeld Theater it was introduced in.
The stars you're seeing have all returned to MGM, the studio that invented the movie musical. They've come together in a kind of labor of love. It will never happen again.
That's Entertainment was a rather risky experiment at the time because no one knew if anyone would want to see a movie like this.
My point was, this is not a documentary. This is a very entertaining picture. And our lead-off line for the film was, more than a movie, it's a celebration.
In the wake of Vietnam and the recent Watergate scandal, this movie came along and filled a need for wholesome, light entertainment.
Nixon was in trouble. Watergate was a part of this thing. The economy was lousy, etc. And so we signed the picture off with a line that worked like gangbusters, which was simply, that's entertainment. Boy, do we need it now. And it just touched the nerve of everybody in the country.
On opening nights, your name in lights, why we won't stop till you reach the top.
To the older audience, this was nostalgia. To the kids watching Esther Williams swimming for 15 minutes underwater and never breathing.
Or the amazing Fred Astaire doing the impossible on the ceiling. Pure cam.
And to MGM, it saved the company.
Dancing and singing in the rain.
Andy Casey, very good. You're gonna do it again, Victoria. Stop smiling. It's not the high school play. OK? count.
A 5, 6, 7.
Making this trailer with Bob Fosse was an unbelievable experience. Not only was he a brilliant dancer, but nobody could cut film like Fosse.
In 1968, a revolutionary piece of entertainment was written and played for the first time. It was the creation of an extraordinary British composer, Peter Townsend. It was performed by an incredible music group called The Who. Columbia Pictures and Robert Stigwood are proud to announce Tommy, the movie.
We live in a visual world. With a motion picture, you are talking to a very special audience. You have to know who you're talking to. And I think that the use then of imagery, of sound, of silence, of effects, becomes very much a part of a very emotional product. There is no product more emotional than a movie.
Anne Margaret, the mother. Oliver Reed, the lover. Jack Nicholson, the doctor. Eric Clapton, the preacher. Tina Turner, the acid queen. Elton John, the pinball wizard. Keith Moon, Uncle Ernie. The music, The Who. Roger Daltrey, Tommy. Tommy, your senses will never be the same. Tommy, the movie.
Well, up next we have another film with its advertising hook baited by Mr. Frankfurt. It's Kramer versus Kramer. From Columbia Pictures in 1979, starring Dustin Hoffman, Meryl Streep, and young Justin Henry as the Kramers. A Manhattan family tossed into turmoil when Mrs. Kramer divorces Mr. Kramer. Now, it's an exceptionally touching and powerful drama, but one that was also deemed a tough sell, making it a special challenge for Frankfurt.
I have a reputation of running into burning buildings. They used to kid me about this all the time. We would always find, or I would always find, a tough problem, one that theoretically was unsolvable, and then we try to see if we could figure out a way to solve it.
He decided to ground the entire campaign, the movie posters, trailers, and all other advertisements, around a family portrait of the Kramers, one that showed an average happy family.
I got involved with Kramer versus Kramer for two reasons. One, I was fascinated with what I heard the story was about. Two, it was being produced by Stanley Jaffe and directed by Bob Benton, and they were both good friends. We decided a visual image for this that would be quite strong would be a family portrait. But a family portrait in 1980 wasn't a painting anymore. It was a Polaroid image. We reached for a tool we hadn't used before. We use it all the time in making advertising or making storyboards, but we'd never done it with an ad, and that was a Polaroid camera. We wanted to find a brand new way to show a family in a way that we hadn't seen before.
Got some shell in there.
It's all right. You like your French toast crunchy, don't you?
And what you would hear is simply the sound of, again, a macro sound, like that, the sound of a Polaroid picture. It's taken, and the picture finally develops and becomes the image of a happy family, which is what this wasn't about, really.
I'm not saying he doesn't need his father, but I really believe he needs me more than his mother.
Okay, keep it going! That's terrific!
There's a statement at the end, and I remember my daughter Abby pointing this out to me.
Talking about the movie and the book. And what law is it
that says that a woman is a better parent simply by virtue of her sex?
That's what this is really about.
Well, the film eventually did very well at the box office, and it went on to win 5 Academy Awards, including the one for Best Picture of 1979.
I think it's one of the most powerful films that I've ever seen.
Then there was working with the genius of Paddy Chayefsky and Sidney Lumet.
And now,
the distinguished television news commentator, Mr. Howard Beale.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like at this moment to announce that I will be retiring from this program in 2 weeks' time because of poor ratings. Since this show was the only thing I had going for me in my life, I have decided to kill myself. I'm going to blow my brains out right on this program a week from today.
Prepare yourself for a perfectly outrageous motion picture.
There is no America. There is no democracy. There is only IBM and DuPont and Exxon. And you have meddled with the primal forces of nature. And you will atone. Am I getting through to you, Mr. Beale?
Why me?
Because you're on television, dummy.
This was our key art for the one sheet, loved by Patty and Sydney, scared the pants off the studio. So much so, though, it never ran.
I want you to get up now. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs. I want you to get up right now and go to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
I'm mad as hell! I'm not going to take it anymore!
Television will never be the same.
Over the years, I've worked on so many films. God knows I didn't do it alone. I had great people working with me. People like Steve Gordon, Kate Cox, Lou Ducharme, Jonathan Elias, Mike Frankfurt, Shelley Isaacs, Phil Gipps, Kay Gatta, Art Kane, Harvey Plastrick, Tony Silver, Arnie Skolnick, Gina Stone, Tony Schwartz, Mark Schmugger, Leon Prochnick, Barbara Gipps, David Altshuler, Dick Anderson, Joe Toto, Patty Baird. The list goes on and on.
It's always been a piece of me that's been really stuck in Hollywood.